morning, everybody. I want to thank Sergeant Platt for inviting me to come out here and speak to you today and share my story with you. As mentioned, I work for Global Force University Police. It's in Greene County, just east of Xenia. But on January 1st of 2011, I was a part-time police officer working for German Township in Clark County. My shift was scheduled to start from, I was scheduled to work 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. At 11:30, I was going about my duties, patrolling in the Upper Valley Mall parking lot. I was actually in the middle of issuing a parking citation for a vehicle. And at 11:34, dispatch sent out a call of shots fired. It happened at the campground at Eden Beach, Ohio. And they had dispatched Deputy Hopper and Deputy Sergeant Dusty White. In Clark County, shots fired is not an uncommon call to hear. Most of the time it is folks that are target shooting or hunting on their many acres of land that they have down there. But they still send two officers down there, so Deputy White, Sergeant White, Deputy Hopper responded. A few minutes later, Sergeant White got on the radio and announced that he had heard a second shot while they were on scene. And it was shortly after that that he put out over the radio that Deputy Hopper was down. She had been shot by someone. They still didn't know who. And he could not get to her body. It was later found out that he was able to determine the trailer that it came from, because the suspect was inside still holding his rifle. And they were having a stare down, Deputy White and the suspect. I immediately dropped everything I was doing. Eden Beach was about 8 miles from my location. Up until that point, and since that day, I had never driven so fast in my life to get to the scene. I wasn't very familiar with the layout of the campground, having never been there before, but I passed it every day on the way to work and on my way home, so I knew where it was. But I got there, parked my cruiser, and I began looking for lot 84. I was the second backup officer to arrive, so I didn't even have a reference point. There was nobody posted up anywhere, so I had to go find lot 84. Once I found it, I took a position up behind a tree, roughly about 40 yards away from the trailer. As officers were arriving and taking up posts, and everybody was trying to figure out where they want them and how we were going to approach this scene, I actually wanted to move closer. I had my sidearm at the time, and I knew from 40 yards away, if I had to engage, I probably wasn't going to be very effective with just my sidearm. So I got a little bit closer. I got a lot closer, actually. I ended up taking a position next to the trailer next door to lot 84, and now I was about 15 feet away. Deputy Hopper's body was about 10 feet in front of me. Laying in front of the door of the suspect's trailer. She wasn't moving, her chest wasn't rising, no signs of life. And I think everybody knew that there was not a whole lot that we could do for her at that time. But we still had an armed suspect inside this trailer. I'm not sure exactly how much time went by, but they were able to get a police cruiser pulled up close to the suspect's trailer. And using the PA system, attempted to communicate with this individual. We still didn't know who he was, how many weapons he had inside, what kind, if there very limited more people inside of it. The communication attempts were met with no response. Shortly after that, an older woman showed up on scene who turned out to be the suspect's girlfriend. So now we had this gentleman's name, knew he was in there by himself, and he did have access to numerous weapons with an unknown amount of ammunition. And his name was Michael Farragher. Communication was attempted again with him, this time using his girlfriend to try and speak to him, hoping that he would respond positively to her. Again, no response. He didn't want to have any part of what was going on outside of his trailer. The trailer that he was in was an Airstream trailer. They're fairly small. He had all the windows closed, all the curtains were pulled over the window except for one that was facing north. The officers that were able to look inside of his trailer were advising everybody what was going on, and this gentleman was going about like nothing had happened. It did not seem to faze him what he had just done, that his trailer was surrounded, and that he is going to jail today, or even worse, not going to make it out alive. After several attempts, several minutes worth of attempting to communicate with Mr. Ferryman, Sheriff Kelly, who had arrived on scene to render assistance and take control of the scene, had given an order that if anybody had a clear shot, they had the okay to take it. Moments after that, I don't know who fired the first shot, but a shot rang out through the trailer. The windows broke, glass fell out onto the grass. I, along with other law enforcement officers on scene that day, assumed that Mr. Ferryman was resuming his attack on us and was firing at us. So we engaged Mr. Ferryman. With the curtains closed, there was really nothing solid for any of us to aim at. We did not have a target. So many officers from many jurisdictions across Clark County and the surrounding area began engaging onto the trailer. The shooting lasted for about 30 seconds. It seemed like it lasted longer than that. There was a ceasefire call, and during that time we were going to reassess the situation and figure out how to proceed from there. During that ceasefire, Mr. Ferryman took that opportunity to get off one last shot. And that was the shot that struck me. I remember seeing the muzzle blast, flash from the muzzle coming through the window. The curtains were closed so nobody could see him stand up and take his aim. All we saw was the muzzle flash. Something inside me knew, I just knew that he was aiming for me. I don't know why, but I just knew he was aiming for me. And I froze. It was only a split second, but that's all that it takes. I ended up getting struck in my upper left arm. It was a shotgun blast with birdshot. And from 15 feet away, birdshot doesn't have a lot of distance to spread out, so I ended up taking the majority of it into my arm and in my sides. I remember it knocked me over onto the right-hand side, which put me into the field of fire away from my cover and concealment. And it was the worst pain I'd ever felt in my life, up till that day or ever since. The way that I felt, I thought that my arm had been blown off because I couldn't see it and I couldn't feel it. But as I continued to roll over, my left arm fell down, and I was able to utilize it to crawl back to safety. There were plenty of officers there to take up my position and continue to engage, so I knew it wasn't necessary that I stay in this fight. I had to get back and get medical attention. So I began crawling back behind the camper. The next few minutes were very fast, very hectic. I just remember bodies grabbing me up, dragging me back somewhere. They started taking off my gear, taking off my uniform. I was placed on a stretcher, placed in an ambulance, and taken to one of the care flight helicopters on standby. And off I went. They took me to Miami Valley Hospital.